I'm an expert in environmental quality of the Ministry of Environment, and at present, I'm the coordinator of RELASC on behalf of the Ministry of Environment in Peru. Starting 2020, our technical seminars have been held online. So we invite you to visit our site, www.relask.org, so that you can access our mail list for our future technical seminars and important information about contaminated sites. Without further ado, I will give the floor to Mr. Eric Concepcion, who is the Director of Environmental Quality and Ecoefficiency of the Ministry of Environment, to give a few opening words. Thank you, Pedro. Good morning. I expect you are listening to me appropriately. Welcome. I'm here to give you a very warm welcome to all the attendees, the panelists, my working team here at the Ministry of Environment. I'm Director of Environmental Quality and Ecoefficiency that is responsible for all the rules and standards related to prospection, water, contaminated sites, soils. So within this framework, as a government authority, it's very important to participate in these RELASC activities. From the very beginning, the Ministry of Environment is promoting a sustainable use of soils and aims at preventing the damage of soils because of due to any activity. And the tools, the base key tools that we use are the environmental standards. As far as contaminated sites are concerned, we use these standards and criteria for contaminated sites management. The environmental contaminated sites standards are the framework that sets forth the concentrations that may be applied to soils in order to protect their condition and their impact on human health. When I say contaminated sites environmental criteria, this means a process to apply specific criteria to these contaminated sites and determine their degree of impact. So this involves identification, characterization, and after that, we design a plan for the restoration, remediation, and execution. From 2013, our bureau belongs to this network, and we are very interested in expand this work to all Latin America. For us, RELASC is a cornerstone network, not only as far as the standards are concerned, but also to share experiences and to exchange successful case studies to allow us to have feedback and exchange information among countries like Argentina, Brazil, Costa Rica, Ecuador, and others. And these technical seminars are fundamental, and it's essential to have them year after year in order to aim at our improvement as far as technical issues are concerned, the essays, our techniques, and to have as well the state-of-the-art information that help us, that assist us in our assessments and studies. So I welcome you all, and I'm very thankful for having you here in this first technical seminar of this year, sampling techniques of soil gases using active samplings for the correct and efficient characterization of the area, assessment and mitigation of vapor intrusion. Thank you so much, Engineer Eric. And before giving the floor to Guilherme to start the presentation, let me explain to you at the bottom of your screen, you have a section for questions and answers. In this chat, questions and answers, you can write down any question that you may have along the webinar. So please do not write your questions in the chat box, but in the questions and answer box. After the presentation, we are going to distribute and classify the questions. So at the end of the presentation, our panelists may answer to your questions. So please, I ask you not to use the chat box for asking questions, but write them down in the questions and answer box. Thank you.
Thank you, Pedro. I'd like to thank you everyone for coming today. We organized this webinar to focus on the forms of approach to assess a contaminated site, and we will cover basic concepts of sampling techniques and case studies. Today, we have professionals with extensive experience in environmental projects, and we hope that you can learn and or improve your knowledge of the topic. So we're going to start with Willen. He works for Arcadis do Brasil. Thank you, Willen.
You can see my screen?
Yes, we can see your screen.
Okay, so thank you, everyone. First of all, we'd like to thank RELESC and the organization for this opportunity. And it's an honor to be here talking about such an important topic. And I'm not talking about just for vapor intrusion, but as talked before about human health. That's why we developed all these techniques and we have to do all these work to be sure that people can use properties assets safely. So my name is William, I'm a Brazilian. I'm an environmental engineer and work within Arcadis for 3 years with site evaluation and restoration projects. I'm not Spanish or English speaker, so I would like to thank the translators and the public and apologize in advance if I commit some grammar mistakes, okay? So to cover the first part of my talking, I will talk about a little historical evolution in São Paulo and Brazil about contaminated site management. Arcadis is a global company and we are located around all the globes, but I would like to highlight that we have offices here in Brazil, in 3 states here, and also Chile and Peru, but we have problems in projects in other countries too, such as Argentina. So when soil and groundwater contamination first got attention here in São Paulo, first case got attention in the late 70s, but a lot of other cases existed at the time. I would like to highlight these ones that I will cover because they got media attention and also caused a lot of health issues for workers and people who lived near these contaminated sites. So this is an old chemical plant here located in Cubatão, which produced some organochloride products such as pentachlorophenol, known here in Brazil as China powder, pó da China or something like that, which is a pesticide, carbon tetrachloride and perchloroethylene. I think Craig and Laurie will cover a lot of chlorinated solvents too. 20,000 of hazard waste were disposed directly on soil in open areas. And the first phase of disposal of this waste were in their property on the site. So at this time it was regulated and legal to dispose of waste in the properties. The second phase, when all the soils and the places were filled with waste, they started to dump it near the roads here in the coastal cities. So we got some this irregular disposal on São Vicente and also Itanhaém, 8 kilometers away from chemical plant. And after that, there was a lot of first health problems and workers related to this contamination, mainly for pentachlorophenol. And this caused a lot of media attention. So public attorney decided to close and to the end to phase out the operation of this chemical plant. And they had to deal with a lot of contaminated waste and remediation. So more than 60,000 tons of soils were excavated and incinerated at the time. And there is a problem when you incinerate chlorinated compounds. If you do not have properly treatment for atmospheric emission, you also had problems with dioxins, inferences, and with atmospheric traveling, you can spread around these contaminations. And remediation is still ongoing at the sites that started in the 70s, and remediation and monitoring is still ongoing. Other relevant historical case, we had a lot of problems with gas stations here in Brazil, mainly in São Paulo, with explosions and problems in the neighborhood. Problems related to odor, they started to see gasoline in groundwater wells, and all these cases leads to a high attention of media and also from public attorney. Also emblematic problem here in São Paulo was a clandestine use of chlorinated solvents deposit, tons of contaminated soils, and still remediations and monitoring ongoing. The problem is of the past owner went to bankruptcy, and now who takes care of this contaminated site is the public, it's the government. So it's a situation that's all we citizens had to deal with and pay for it. And one of the most famous cases here in São Paulo, it's Mantovani Industrial Landfill, which is it was a legal landfill and licensed by CETESB in the 70s. And it received a lot of contaminated waste from all kinds of industrial activities, some related to oil, chlorinated solvent, wastewater, treatment plant sludge, and other inorganics. The problem is the people who lived in the neighborhood start to getting sick because they were drinking contaminated water from their groundwater wells, and also using this groundwater to irrigate their plant, their rural activities. So again, a public attorney went to this case and decided that they have to remediate and solve this problem. But the owner of landfill also bankrupt, and at this case was really emblematic because the companies that disposed of this waste was responsible for dealing with this. So 60 companies were involved to this problem, and huge companies are still paying for this contaminated passive here. So nowadays we have a hydraulic barrier at the site and other activities of remediation. They are deciding what is the best approach, because excavate and destinate should be not the best alternative, because you should cause problems in other areas too. Other relevant historical case is Barão de Mauá, which is a residential buildings here in the state of São Paulo, in the city of Mauá. In the past, these sites were not occupied for any industrial activity or any activity, but the owner of the land disposed foundry sands at the sites. So they didn't have a lot of control who entered the site at the moment, and potential other chemicals and industrial waste was disposed there. After that, this area was sold to the entrepreneur who built these buildings. And in 1960, people moved there. 1,760 families moved to the building. And during
incluido. Y durante el mantenimiento de un ascensor, se produjo un problema relacionado con explosión. ¿Por qué? Por la acumulación de metano, que terminó con el deceso del trabajador y todos los problemas de los contaminantes relacionados con la degradación anaeróbica. Y estamos aquí nuevamente con problemas relacionados con los COBs o componentes orgánicos volátiles. Es muy importante evaluar la existencia de estos componentes para tomar las medidas de seguridad en estas zonas. Ahora, solamente para darles una idea de cuáles han sido las normas y cómo se han evolucionado en el Brasil en 1993, se hizo un intercambio con los holandeses para crear procedimientos de recuperación y evaluación de sitios ambientales. Actualmente, estamos más restringidos a estas informaciones. Eso es muy similar a las normas relacionadas a los estándares del CTSB. Son muy similares a las que se trabajan en Estados Unidos. Posteriormente, en 1999, se redactó el primer manual de gestión de sitios contaminados, que fue muy útil para ayudar a los trabajos de evaluación y remediación aquí en Brasil. Actualmente, ya estamos en nuestra tercera edición y seguimos mejorando y revisando toda esta información, porque ustedes saben bien que la ciencia está en constante cambio y renovación y necesita ser actualizada. En el 2000, la CETESB creó un grupo dedicado simplemente para trabajar con sitios contaminados, porque empezaron a crecer los casos y se necesitaba tener normas específicas para este tipo de casos que se iban encontrando. En el 2000 también, fue que tuvimos problemas relacionados con las licencias y autorizaciones que se estaban dando a las gasolineras en aquel entonces. Poco a poco fueron reduciéndose los problemas, pero gracias a que se puso atención y que se empezó a trabajar en el uso de equipos apropiados, en pruebas de fugas que permitan garantizar que
2001, we got the first soil and groundwater reference values here in São Paulo State. It was really important to have something like this. We have law and we have standards. This way we can imagine in our sites. 2002, we got the first publication of contaminated sites here in Brazil and São Paulo. It is really important for the owners of the land and for people who want to buy on land or other to have transparency on this process. So everybody knows these areas have issues and what stage of the contaminated site management they are and how they are dealing with it. 2009, we got the first national contaminated site assessment and remediation and also standard values. It's CONAMA 420. 2013, we had the first law related contaminated sites here in São Paulo. And it's also really important to base all this work we are doing. And the last one, 2018, we got DD38, which is a really innovative guideline created by CETESB. And it brings not only just standards and how to approach. They mention about vapor intrusion, high resolution site characterization, mass calculation necessary, remediation pilot test or bench test, and others that in the past it was not written in any specific guide or legislation. So this helped us to develop even more how we deal with contaminated sites here in Brazil. So I think this ends my first part of presentation.
Thank you very much. We're going to share our screen now. And I got to click share sound first, Craig.
Can you stop sharing yours, Willem? Oh, there you go.
Yeah. Now, we appreciate Willem sharing all that vital information. We are going to turn off our video just to save on power since we've lost our power here. And we're going to talk about the history of solvents in the U.S.
Okay, first we'll start off with this graph of solvent production. When Lori moves in there a little bit, there we go. What we'll look at is four different compounds, perchloroethylene, PCE, trichloroethylene, TCE, 111 TCA, and carbon tetrachloride in yellow. Along the bottom of the graph are the years from 1921 through 2010. And along the left-hand side are millions of pounds of production. So each one of those graphs goes up to almost a billion pounds of production in a single year.
Yeah, so in the 40s and 50s, chlorinated solvents were used as a replacement for petroleum-based products.
In the 60s, 70s, and 80s, that's when solvent use really reached its peak and was sort of the golden age of solvents, and they were used for everything by every industry.
In the 90s, production fell sharply as opposed to following the amendments to the Clean Air Act.
And in 1970, TCE production peaked at 600 million pounds that one year, approximately 1 million drums of TCE.
That's a lot of TCE. And if you think about it, an environmental manager with 30 years of experience has essentially no personal knowledge of how those solvents were used because he or she was not there when they were being used at the facility.
So how were solvents used? Back in the heyday, in the 60s and 70s and 50s even, you know, after World War II, the U.S. and Southern American countries were kind of rebuilding the world so that we were doing a lot of production of a lot of products. From cars to Washington machines to refrigerators, all of those had a solvent use. When a lot of the GIs came back from the war, they decided to start family businesses. And one of the ones that a lot of them started was dry cleaning. So every little community across the US had at least one or two dry cleaners, and they brought in solvents.
Tenían solventes, utilizaban gran cantidad de solventes y tenían que reciclar esto en ese momento y tenían que ver dónde hacer estas prácticas de eliminación. Literalmente se utilizaba en todo, en pintura, en electrónica, en medicina. Y también en la medicina se les daba a las mujeres embarazadas que recién habían tenido un bebé, alucinen. Y en las... la lucha contra incendios también. Y ellos utilizaban estos solventes directamente para poder controlar los fuegos y en la industria farmacéutica y en los controles de plagas. Estos son algunos campos donde se utilizaban los solventes. Entonces, en las prácticas de eliminación en ese entonces, tenemos alguna información, alguna de las fuentes publicadas de la Asociación de Químicos de Manufactura en 1968. Y simplemente las ponían en como en la misma tierra, en estas arenas secas. Simplemente las eliminaban directamente ahí y luego esto permitía que se evaporaran en la atmósfera. También las enterraban en los suministros de agua. Ahora vamos a los modelos conceptuales de sitios y ahora cómo saben el uso de solventes y cómo se eliminaban. Veamos este concepto de modelo conceptual de sitio. Vamos a ver la intrusión o qué es un modelo conceptual de solventes en cuestión de intrusión de vapores. ¿Qué data necesitamos y qué es lo que se viene respecto a estos modelos conceptuales de sitio? Veamos, básicamente es un modelo, es el conocimiento del modelo. Entonces, tenemos problemas de vapores potenciales, pueden ser los compuestos orgánicos volátiles, clorados de petróleo, metano, mercurio, pueden ser parte del estudio como vapores, las fuentes de vapores, la migración de vapores, cómo migran a través de los suelos y puede ir a los cimientos de edificaciones o ir a sitios no habitados y tienen trayectorias preferenciales. También vamos a tener las poblaciones receptoras posibles, también en estas áreas industrializadas. Son estos empleados que trabajan en esas identificaciones. Entonces, la fuente de datos, tenemos la información de fuentes de contaminantes, de las fugas, tenemos los datos de gas, de subsuelos externos, los datos de aires ambientales y de aire en interiores, y también los estándares y guías regulatorias. Y acá podemos utilizar estos datos para ver las zonas que vamos a evaluar y la forma en que queremos nosotros evaluar estas trayectorias preferenciales. Aquí en estos datos de agua subterránea he puesto un signo de interrogación porque hay mucha. La mayoría que nosotros tenemos hasta la fecha se ha recolectado para las evaluaciones de intrusión de vapores. Si nosotros queremos utilizar esos datos de aguas subterráneas, tienen que ser en el nivel superior de la capa freática. Luego tenemos las clasificaciones de suelos, la estratigrafía y la geología. ¿Cuán permeable es el suelo? ¿Y qué es lo que está controlando las travesías o las trayectorias de estos vapores? Estas fuentes de datos también tenemos información de fuentes contaminantes y las fugas. Y estos mapas de sitios, las fotografías aéreas históricas también son una buena fuente. Y los detalles de construcción de las edificaciones nos dan cómo estas edificaciones están en su forma existente. Y también los datos climáticos, cómo estos vapores han ingresado o salido de las edificaciones. Entonces, como estamos entendiendo las intrusiones de vapores, al remediar esas trayectorias preferenciales, vamos a poder encargarnos de estas intrusiones de vapores. Y también tenemos las compuestos de interés. Si tienen esta lista de estos constituyentes o compuestos de interés, van a poder determinar si el cliente es la fuente de información, cuáles son las otras fuentes contribuyentes de contaminación. Entonces, ¿cuáles son los siguientes pasos? Tenemos estos modelos conceptuales de sitios. Hay dos partes involucradas. En la parte subterránea podemos ver cuáles son las fuentes y cómo esas pueden migrar a través del subsuelo hacia la edificación. Pueden entonces pasar a través del suelo, de algunas grietas, y también puede ir a través de las líneas telefónicas, de las cañerías. Y esto puede contaminar a través del suelo a todo el espacio. Luego tenemos la edificación en sí. Tenemos lo que hay dentro de la edificación, si hay una área adjunta como un garaje, o esos vapores pueden ser parte de su muestra, así que tienen que tener cuidado con ello. Tienen que ver las rajaduras en las edificaciones o en las cañerías también de la propia edificación. Lo siguiente que vamos a hacer entonces, vamos a graficar los datos en nuestro modelo conceptual del sitio y poder visualizar cómo estos datos se relacionan con la propia edificación o con el propio sitio. Lo vamos a ver en unos minutos. Entonces, hablemos de estos métodos. Vamos a ver esa lista de COC de los constituyentes de interés. Si tienen un sitio con clorado, tienen que utilizar este CIS-1,2-dicloroetano. Y esto solamente ocurre en el entorno, no es parte de un producto. Entonces, si tienen en la parte interior, es un indicativo que tienen una intrusión de vapores dentro de la edificación. Por ejemplo, los constituyentes de gas del alcantarillado, como los compuestos bromados, los cloroformos, los tetrahidrofluoranos. Aquí, en las muestras de alta resolución, estas son las herramientas que hay disponibles. Tenemos los Vapor Pin. Es bastante beneficioso, coste efectivo, recoge muchas muestras en un tiempo bastante corto. Ustedes pueden hacer estas inspecciones o controles en los puntos o en los hotspots o puntos calientes y donde ustedes quieren poner estos muestreadores y también tener una campaña de perforación de agujeros mucho más corta. Entonces, para las líneas de evidencia múltiples tenemos que considerar las trayectorias potenciales, recoger los datos de presión diferencial y tienen que visitar toda la edificación, tanto los accesos internos y externos. Es una muy buena práctica y es bastante económica para recolectar información, tanto del suelo, del subsuelo y también considerar los datos climáticos y las variaciones de estaciones, porque seguramente esta guía puede estipular ¿Qué tipo de herramientas utilizar dependiendo de la estación? Tenemos los métodos de interpretación visual para poder interpretar de manera visual los datos. Acá tenemos un ejemplo que le quiero mostrar para entender mejor cómo estos gases de alcantarillado tienen influencia. Nosotros tenemos datos recolectados de gas de alcantarillado por muchos años. Y acá en este diagrama estamos viendo la contribución de los efectos de estas muestras de gas de alcantarillado. Los puntos azules son aire interior, el rojo es gas de suelos y el amarillo tiene el gas de alcantarillado. En la parte superior tenemos el PCE, a la izquierda el TCE y a la izquierda, perdón, los indicadores de gas de alcantarilla y a la derecha los TCE. Estos puntos caen en cada una de estas regiones e indican el índice de concentración. En este caso, acá tenemos que el gas de alcantarillado ha excedido el 50%, es decir, que el 50% de la concentración tiene componentes de gas de alcantarillado y la tendencia más importante es que 35% de las muestras en interiores recolectadas y aproximadamente el 25% del gas en suelo era dominado por indicadores de gas de alcantarillado. Y esto quiere decir que las influencias de estas trayectorias potenciales son de muestras que sacamos de aire interior que no sabíamos antes. Quizás había algún tipo de disrupción de algunas cañerías hacia la edificación y esto muestra que las trayectorias preferenciales son más profundas de lo que pensamos en un inicio y estas trayectorias pueden afectar el entendimiento de los efectos de los gases. Y como mencionamos anteriormente de los sitios, de los modelos de sitios conceptuales, acá tenemos los compuestos clorados. Y esto es, si vemos los compuestos carbonados, tenemos el tetrahidro. El azul es el PCE en su mayoría. El rojo es TCE. Y pueden ver dentro de la casa, pero no de dónde vienen. Pero cuando yo agrego tetrahidrofurano, hay bastante tetrahidrofurano en la parte del gas alcantarillado y se ve en el resto y es una muy buena indicación que hay una fuente de trayectoria preferencial. Luego pasamos al 1,2-DCA y solamente, disculpen el color, no se muestra muy bien en la parte verde en los círculos. Entonces, esto puede significar que hay una atribución dentro de la edificación. Pueden ver en sus datos y determinar de dónde viene esto con precisión. Y luego vamos a utilizar las fuentes históricas de este GIS. Entonces, tenemos la ubicación presente de la tintorería, pero cuando vimos los registros históricos y la fotógrafa.
The dry cleaner was actually at the west end of the building, and in 1950 was in the parking lot. So if you don't understand this and just go to where the present location is, you may miss where the big VOC sources really are. In this case, it's probably in the parking lot when they were just dumping things out the back doors. Yep.
What are the takeaways from these proven methods? First, make sure you consider all of your preferential pathways. They're very important as you move forward. Use high-resolution sampling techniques whenever you can. They can be very cost-effective because you do evaluate quickly, saving time and money. Incorporate GIS to assess historical use. And expand your COC list to include not only breakdown products, but also products that are contributable to sewer gas. Visually evaluate your data on your conceptual site model and revisit it often throughout your project. Always go back and make sure the data is consistent with the model. And if it's not, change the model and move forward. So some active soil sampling techniques. Now we're gonna talk about the tools that you can use. But first, before you do that, there's a lot of tools, a lot of options. You really have to think about what you're trying to achieve and the answers that you'd like to see at the end of your project so that you can know what those best tools are to get you those answers.
The first thing we'll look at is a GC, a portable GC. These are now available. They were used quite a bit in the US, but they're now available in Brazil. But basically you take this portable GC to the site, connect it up to various tubes that you put in different locations and collect samples continuously. And
resolver cosas sin mayor complicación. El siguiente es el detector manual, también está en base a GIS. Es bastante sensible, un instrumento altamente sensible. Al final, no es tan útil como un instrumento portátil y también está disponible en Latinoamérica. Acá tenemos los cilindros Suma, se utilizan mucho en los Estados Unidos. Es muy importante que tienen que ser certificados de manera individual, dependiendo de la caracterización de su sitio y los requisitos de sus guías. Y estas vienen en diferentes volúmenes, de 1 litro, de 6 litros, y eso es para el muestreo de gas de suelo, en su mayoría. Pero cuando pueden llegar hasta de 6 litros y tienen una detección, tienen límites para su detección y, como dijo Lori, se tiene que tener una certificación individual de estos cilindros. Eso es lo que se sugiere y recomienda. Y el PID, eso sí les voy a mostrar cómo se utiliza en nuestros casos de estudios, y ustedes pueden hacer un muestreo de gas de suelo bastante focalizado. Y este PID solamente le da la concentración total en el aire o en la tierra, perdón. Y no se puede hacer un compuesto diferenciado. En este caso, este medidor múltiple de gases podría leerlos. Este vapor pin, este pin de vapores, esto la gente cree que solamente es para intrusión de vapores únicamente, ¿no? Se puede utilizar en varias cosas, para caracterización de fuentes, se puede hacer, recomendamos que sea un espaciado de 5 a 10 metros, pero se puede utilizar con un patrón más ancho y utilizar a la vez un PID y tener varias lecturas, y se puede instalar tan rápidamente que pueden cambiar todo el espacio de la cuadrícula según la extensión de su campo. Y también es muy bueno para las evaluaciones de intrusión de vapores. Es una herramienta manual, se instala, no es intrusiva, no tiene fugas, se conecta en esa punta que sale. En la parte superior tiene conexiones flexibles en caso quieren hacer con un tubo de TOC 17 o conectar un accesorio. Y hemos utilizado NTAC para poder conectarlo con una bolsa Tedlar, y lo pueden dejar por un largo tiempo para un monitoreo de largo plazo. Ese es un cambio en los Estados Unidos y en Canadá también, y en el Reino Unido están requiriendo que se hagan las evaluaciones debajo de ese muestreador de vapor. Y esto lo pueden instalar en pre y post construcción, y es un inserto, solamente necesita un inserto como cualquier otra penetración en las cañerías. Se puede utilizar y se puede instalar este pin de vapor o vapor pin y empezar con el muestreo. Y eso permite hacer en monitoreos de largo tiempo. Y para la presión de extensión de campos de presión, no hay ningún tipo de fugas. Estas mediciones son bastante precisas de la presión. Se puede permanecer en el lugar por mucho tiempo para un monitoreo de largo tiempo. Puede estar en diferentes tipos de sitios. Con ello, Este es como se ve cuando se le hace, cuando se le monta el vapor pin o el vapor pin. Acá está conectado a un cilindro suma y también para el monitoreo de largo plazo o de largo tiempo. Otra técnica de muestreo. Esta es una cámara de flujo. Este es un ejemplo. Esta es una bastante grande. No necesitan una tan grande, pero este para mostrarle este, cómo se muestrea. Y esto es lo que recoge los vapores que salen de la superficie del suelo. Es bastante útil, pero es bastante complicado de instalar. Tiene varias cosas que instalar. Pero mucha gente los están utilizando dentro de las edificaciones para ver si su suelo o la losa de concreto está contaminada y ponen eso en diferentes áreas y medir lo que sale de los gases que salen de las losas o de los suelos. Y también se puede ver para las trayectorias preferenciales cómo estas hacen su recorrido. Y vamos a ver una demostración de su instalación y del vapor pin. Y tenemos aquí una demo en vivo en este video. Hola. Ahora les quiero mostrar cómo instalar el vapor pin, este instrumento. Y hay un par de cosas que quiero mencionarles. Vamos a instalar. Este es un vapor pin flexible. Tiene aquí esta punta. Y este es una manguita de silicona que va como sellador. No está tan arriba. Se le deja una pequeña distancia antes del borde. Y una vez que lo ponen en el campo, ustedes van a ver cómo esto va a reaccionar. Ya hemos hecho este agujero de 5 pulgadas. Y acá, esta es la manija de extracción. Acá tenemos este agujero que se ajusta perfectamente a la punta del vapor pin. Voy a hacer eso inmediatamente. En este minuto voy a ponerme mis guantes. Y vas a ver en esta prueba de fugas también. Eso también se puede hacer. Se puede hacer con el agua y con agua y presión. Y eso es probablemente lo que se va a hacer en muchos casos. Entonces voy a poner el vapor pin en el agujero que está abierto aquí. Vamos a poner esta manija de extracción y lo vamos a martillar. Vamos a hundirlo en el agujero. Y eso es todo lo que necesitan hacer. Es fácil, de manera inmediata. Y simplemente va a ir y se puede ver un poquito de rebaba o los bordes que salen, unas protuberancias. Pero esa es la manguita de la silicona que está forrando el vapor pin. Y lo siguiente que van a hacer, se le deja un rato para que se asiente y podemos conectar nuestra sonda de prueba o este tubo de prueba para hacer la prueba. Lo vamos a hacer con agua. Y eso lo haces tú mismo, ¿verdad? Vamos a poner esto es una plastilina hecha en casa. Es importante que ustedes que hayan incluido o incorporado estos compuestos orgánicos volátiles para poder hacer la prueba. Y esto es plastilina que les dije hecha en casa. Entonces, he hecho aquí como una lombriz o una culebrita que le estoy poniendo en la parte inferior de este acoplamiento que viene en nuestro kit. Entonces eso lo colocan sobre esta sonda alrededor de nuestro vapor pin. Le echamos agua, la idea es que si el agua se queda sobre las conexiones, sobre estos conectores, no tenemos ninguna fuga. Ahora ustedes pueden empezar con el muestreo. Lo siguiente que quiero mostrarles es otra instalación. Acá tenemos ya esto montado. Acá tenemos este cilindro ya montado. Estoy sacándole la cubierta. Le he sacado esta cubierta de seguridad. Tiene estas roscas para que sea una instalación permeable. Vamos a quitar esta pequeña tapa. Este es. Y así es como funciona. Les voy a mostrar la prueba de presión, pero antes les voy a mostrar lo que tenemos. Tenemos aquí una bomba manual que va hacia la válvula. Tenemos otro medidor, otro manómetro de presión conectado, y esto corre por este tubo hasta la válvula. Y esto va al cilindro suma, y tenemos que asegurarse que están ajustados todas esas conexiones, y tenemos que ver qué tan conectadas y ajustadas están estas conexiones. Entonces vamos a cerrar todo luego de que se empiece a bombear la presión. Entonces empezamos a bombear, y aquí en este manómetro, en esta válvula, vamos a ver que corre y que pasa la presión. Y vamos a ajustarlo, y vamos a ver que lentamente empieza a bajar. Y es porque estos manómetros manuales son notorios. Entonces vamos a cerrar la bomba manual, y pueden ver aquí, al cerrar la válvula, se ha cerrado. Entonces, este sistema, no hay ninguna fuga en este cilindro de suma alfa. Se puede ver un lector, y acá también, que se ha cerrado muy bien. Una vez que ya saben cómo funciona toda esta instalación, vamos a cerrar esta y aislar esa porción, porque no queremos que esta parte esté en el muestreo. Vamos a conectar esta sonda al vapor pin. Vamos a revisar las válvulas nuevamente, y luego van a poder abrir esta válvula, y tienen una conexión ahora entre esta parte de donde está el subsuelo hasta aquí. Y esta válvula, cuando ya están listos para muestrear, la pueden abrir, y ahora van a tener una prueba de agua incorporada. Si lo quieren hacer, le echan agua directamente. ¡Ay! Salieron algunos bichos. Entonces lo ven y verifican si hay algún tipo de fuga de agua alrededor de este vapor pin, con la idea de que si hay algún tipo de aire saliendo, entrando. Entonces aquí si hay algún tipo de burbuja, ¿verdad? Y aquí empiezan y abren esta válvula. Una de las cosas que queremos mostrarles también es cómo extraer el vapor pin. Entonces, tengo que retirar el agua con una jeringa. Y sería bueno que tengan una jeringa, una hipodérmica, para hacer el retiro del agua. Entonces acá tenemos esta jeringa, vamos a sacar el agua. Y una cosa que hemos notado de esta plastilina hecha a mano es que sí, se vuelve un poquito aguada en la parte interior, así que tengan cuidado cuando saquen el acople, y quizás al final no sea tan limpio. Y acá tenemos nuestras papel toalla para limpiar el espacio, el lugar. Bien, entonces para retirar este vapor pin, primero vamos a sacar la sonda, van a utilizar la manija de extracción, la van a enroscar al vapor pin de esta forma, y van a sentir que ya está enganchado. Y en ese punto, cuando igual sigan enroscando, y así eventualmente el vapor pin va a ir enroscándose en la manija de desenrosque, y de verdad no traten de sacarlo a presión, sino sigan desenroscando y el vapor pin va a salir y ustedes pueden jalar la manija. En la instalación inicial, recuerden que esto está sellado.
Vamos a ver todos esos métodos que, de los que acabamos de hablar. Empecemos ahora con los COV coordinados en los clorados en el agua subterránea, en un sitio, en un lugar que era totalmente industrial y que había estado operando desde 1938 con una larga historia de uso de solventes. Esta evaluación estaba restringida solamente en la noche, así que no se podía hacer la evaluación cuando las cosas estaban ocurriendo, solamente podíamos trabajar en la noche, así que era restringido. Ahora, en la evaluación previa, hablamos con el gerente ambiental para pedir información. Empezamos a revisar los registros que tenían de los desengrasantes y también empezamos a buscar la información sobre el percloroetileno, que nos dimos cuenta que ese era el solvente que se utilizaba en el lugar anteriormente. La profundidad hasta el agua subterránea era más o menos de 20 a 30 pies y empezamos a pensar entonces a qué nivel se daba esta contaminación. Para eso utilizamos entonces los vapor pins para recolectar las muestras de gas de suelo en 156 puntos en una sola semana. Sabíamos que con base a los resultados o se demolería el edificio o se harían los trabajos de remediación. Recordemos que solamente podíamos trabajar en la noche, así que simplemente hacíamos las muestras, extraíamos las muestras y tapábamos los orificios y así sustantivamente todas las noches. Ahora utilizábamos entonces un medidor multigas para hacer un mejor modelo conceptual del sitio, para saber y asegurarnos que estamos obteniendo el gas de suelo. Pero los contenidos se presentaban bastante altos. ¿Dónde ocurrían esto? ¿Dónde estaban las líneas de las alcantarillas o dónde estaban las conexiones eléctricas? Pero fue muy útil para identificar dónde estaban las rutas preferentes del recorrido. Las lecturas del detector de fotoionización indicaron que los contaminantes estaban en las áreas en las que no se pensaban originalmente que estaban los contaminantes, porque originalmente se pensaba que era donde se habían estado utilizando los desengrasantes, pero ese no era el caso. Ahora, las muestras de gas de suelo debajo de la sola que se obtuvieron en cada punto donde se colocó el vapor pin mostraron perfectamente cuáles eran los datos del PCE, por ejemplo, del percloroetileno, del tetracloroeteno también, y dónde estaba el TCE. Y finalmente, con todos estos resultados de laboratorio, identificamos la presencia de las concentraciones del rango del DENAPL, del PCE, y miren, el que están los puntos azules y el TCE, que estaba en rojo en el suelo, se encontraban en una profundidad de 15 pies. Así que solamente imagínense tomando una pequeña muestra debajo de la sola, debajo de la losa, perdón, encontrábamos altas concentraciones. Utilizando la cromatografía de gas y la fotografía aérea, pudimos identificar que la fuga se produjo en los 50 y empezamos a relacionarlo con los registros que teníamos y nos dimos cuenta que el tipo de operación se realizaba en esa época y cómo es que se habían estado realizando estas descargas. La conversación, las entrevistas que teníamos con el gerente ambiental, él no tenía ni idea de que esto ocurría. Esa es la importancia de atener este enfoque y de investigar cuáles son los registros históricos, los antecedentes de cada lugar. Luego hicimos trabajos de remediación del área utilizando extracción de vapor de suelo, SBE, y también las inyecciones del hierro cerovalente emulsificado. Hicimos una evaluación de intrusión de vapor también para determinar cómo íbamos a hacer y finalmente trabajamos la mitigación de intrusión del suelo que se viene trabajando hasta ahora utilizando esta vapor pin que permite recolectar las presiones para monitorear lo que está ocurriendo. Ahora, vayamos a ver, revisemos otro caso. Este es una zona de manufactura que ha venido operando desde 1800. y que se había programado su demolición. Sin embargo, había tenido muchos antecedentes de almacenamiento de petróleo y tampoco se conocía cómo habían utilizado y si habían utilizado solvente. Así que, por lo tanto, se hizo una preevaluación. Realizamos varios registros, entrevistamos a varios operadores que nos mostraron que en algún momento hubo una gasolinera en esa zona. Utilizamos entonces los vapor pins para hacer un estudio de cuáles eran las condiciones de gas en el suelo en 90 puntos y lo hicimos en 2 días. Como les digo, el detector de fotoionización puede ser muy útil cuando tenemos que hacer ese tipo de trabajos. Los resultados de ese estudio identificaron los puntos donde se encontraban las altas concentraciones y eso nos permitió hacer un muestreo de gas de suelo adicional. Y cuando analizamos los resultados, obtuvimos información que nos indicó que no había que hacer mayores trabajos de remediación. Luego, cuando el área fue vendida al nuevo constructor, allí completaron otros ensayos y orificios en el suelo y no llegaron a ubicar otras fuentes de preocupación. Así que, bueno, en eso se quedaron muy contentos con el trabajo que hicimos, porque el trabajo que hicimos en realidad fue confirmado posteriormente con los resultados que hizo el nuevo constructor. Tenemos aquí ahora el caso de una construcción industrial en Oklahoma que tenían muy poca información sobre si habían utilizado solventes o no. Esta era una construcción de 450,000 pies cuadrados y nosotros trabajamos nuestra evaluación con un equipo de 4 personas que recolectaron muestras de gas de suelo con 275 vapor pins en 4 días. Y tratamos de, fíjense ustedes, acá estamos mostrando una fotografía tratando de ubicar dónde es que podíamos encontrar algunos problemas. Ahora, cuando completamos la evaluación de los datos utilizando las herramientas de GIS en tan pocos días para evaluar esta construcción tan grande, se determinó que había un número muy limitado de zonas que generaban o que fueran materia de preocupación, en realidad, debajo de la losa. Por eso, el cliente decidió planificar la demolición de la construcción sin mayor problema, reduciendo además los costos. Luego, tenemos otro proyecto de desarrollo en Illinois, con una fuente de intrusión de vapor en una construcción de 60,000 pies cuadrados. El consultor anterior había determinado 2 años antes, pero no había podido encontrar la fuente. Así que déjenme mostrarles ahorita aquí, por ejemplo, donde hicimos los orificios de suelo, son los triángulos amarillos y los círculos rojos son los orificios monitoreados. Ahí fue donde se extrajeron las muestras. Así que Cox Colding nos llamó y nos instalamos, hicimos el estudio, sacamos las muestras y en 2 días hicimos todo el trabajo. Luego se utilizó el detector de fotoionización para hacer el estudio del sitio y las muestras recolectadas en cada uno de estos puntos. Y encontramos el PCE, el tetracloroetano. Luego, estas son las muestras de TCE. Fíjense que no hay mayores problemas, pero sí encontramos TCA, el tricloretano. Esto fue lo que nos permitió hacer un modelo de conceptual del sitio muy preciso en tan solo una semana. Solo permítanme recordarles ahora dónde es que tomaron las muestras. Fíjense, aquí había un taller de máquinas, pero después se puso una zona de recepción y no pensaron que era necesario recolectar muestras ahí, así que no lo hicieron al principio. Ahora, el otro factor importante que debemos recuperar de este trabajo es que ellos estaban buscando intrusión de vapor, pero no tomaron las muestras para determinar eso en el pasado. Y ahora déjenme explicarles un poco muy rápidamente sobre el trabajo de debida diligencia en este sitio. Teníamos edificios residenciales y en uno se había construido encima de donde anteriormente había existido una zona de lavado, una de lavandería. Así que no nos permitían en realidad entrar a la construcción ni recolectar muestras. Sin embargo, nos permitieron recolectar las muestras de gas de suelo del asfalto de las zonas que eran circundantes a la construcción. Y en 4 horas pudimos instalar todos nuestros vapor pins, recolectar muestras y evaluar en campo y decir, sí, aquí hay un problema de intrusión de vapor en este edificio. Así que después de ello, ya pudimos obtener permiso para entrar al edificio, recolectar algunas muestras de aire interior y encontramos que efectivamente tenían un problema de intrusión de vapor que necesitaba ser mitigado. Y eso le permitió al cliente ahorrarse dinero y empezar a trabajar en el proceso de mitigación inmediatamente. Unos meses después ya tenían implementado un sistema de mitigación que les permitió ahorrar el problema. Y ahora quisiera que Wilma tenga más tiempo para compartir algunos estudios de caso. Y también queremos que ustedes puedan hacer sus preguntas. Así que nosotros también somos parte de la Asociación de Expertos de Intrusión de Vapores, así que pueden también revisar esa información o ingresar a la página web. Pero acá están nuestros datos por si quieren contactarnos para mayor información. Muchísimas gracias por su atención. Muchas gracias por su presentación. Voy a compartir ahora mi pantalla. ¿La pueden ver?
Yes, we can see it, Willem.
Yes, okay. So moving on, I will present 2 cases here, and one related to petroleum hydrocarbon and one of another for chlorinated solvent. And we will have all this information that Laurie and Craig gave to us. So it was a really important presentation before. So they present all the background that I need to talk about my cases here, right? So as they approach at the site, it was a industrial site with automobilistic industry. We need to find the source and we did not have a lot of information. So the first step, we installed 300 temporary subslab probes, such as vapor pin, and provided PID readings, VOC readings in daily basis. So as you can see at this animation, I think you can see my pointer. We have these high concentrations Z's at the bottom of this animation, but at some days we got some high concentrations in the upright here. So this is an important information. So vapors and VOCs and concentrations are changes regarding temperature differential, temperature, wind speed, if we are talking about indoor air, also humidity and other potential weather conditions, right? So as we can see here, we find like 2 hotspots here, the most important part here, and one top of valve here, right? So the next step we did at the site, we need to understand what are our contaminants of concern. So I could not provide sampling for all these 300 points. So a TO15 sample, it's really expensive compared to other kind of samples. So at this case, we took around 30 samples with Tedlar bags, and really similar to what Craig said about, we took a vapor from the temporary probe with a syringe, and then put in the bag and sent to the lab. This Tedlar bag analysis has a higher quantification limit, so it's not good for human health risk assessment or take interventions and decide about remediation or anything. It's just to understand what are the compounds of concern and the orders of magnitude of the contaminants. And they have a problem because they have external interference. So we need to hurry up and send them to the lab as quick as soon, right? Since they are transparent and we have influence of light. And comparing to TO15, it's 10 times higher, the price here in Brazil, but they have high quality, low quantification limit. So we are able to get even low concentrations at the soil. And here in Brazil, it's necessary provide leak testing with Ilion, and tracer gas, and I will highlight this further, right? So the results are here. We took samples from these two parts of the site, as I mentioned before, and we got here, it's a petroleum hydrocarbon plumes with some petroleum aromatic hydrocarbons here. Styrene, ethyl benzene, xylenes, and trimethyl benzenes, all of them in this part of the site here. Okay, this part of the site was, it's not related actually to the source. They have some solvent tanks under storage tanks here, but there's a pipe that runs out here, and that's what caused the contamination, as we can see here. So as you can see, the quantification limits 500 ppbs, and when you talk about TO15, these quantification limits were really, really low. So based on that, first of all, one of the things that Claire and Laurie and Craig said, it's about a conceptual site model, right? So the results fits with the solvent composition. So the solvents that were at the tanks in the site really had the composition of the same compounds that I found in my soil gas analysis. So it was really important to understand what happened. So I know that was the solvents that was storage at the tanks, and in some part of the pipes had some leaking. So after that information, we got some soil samplings, and I highlight one here. This soil sampling SD47R was placed in a ethyl benzene hotspot area and feeds to the PID readings hotspot area. And that part of the site we used direct push with dual tube, since we have a lot of chance to be at the source zone, and we don't want to put the contamination to the depth part of the effort. So we decide to use direct push with dual tube here. And also provide a vertical screening with PID reading. So the first part was horizontal readings with PID to understand where the contaminants are, and then vertically to understand what depth is the contaminants. And the results are here. We provide some soil, VOC soil samples, and we got higher concentrations even in the VEDO zone. So that means that we are really close or in the source zone. So these concentrations were higher than our MCL at the site, and also higher than our specific site target level for indoor inhalation was calculated in human health risk assessment. So this the vapor intrusion screening helped us to find the source zone, and after that address the right way to measurement the site and provide soil gas depressurization systems and also remediation for this area. At the same time, although the soil samplings, we provide the groundwater samplings in all wells. We have at least 200 wells, groundwater monitoring wells at the site. And these attached areas are risk areas regarding areas that contamination are above SSTLs for indoor inhalation. So these areas are potential for vapor intrusion risks related to the contaminants that we have. And we have on groundwater ethyl benzene concentrations, as we first saw in Tedlar bags results, and also 1,2,4 trimethyl benzene. Both of them are petroleum hydrocarbon compounds. Based on that, we provide a vapor monitoring net. So we have sub-slab probes in pink here and purple, and also vapor wells in open air areas. So we provide some vapor wells also at the site, right, in blue. And also we provide some indoor areas in the areas that we know that we should have problems. But the vapor intrusion screening, then we got some samples with Tedlar bag. After that, we provide some soil investigation, groundwater investigation, provide human health risk assessment for concentrations, and then define the sub-slab and vapor monitoring net. So for vapor intrusion, for vapor sampling here in Brazil, we got some steps before sampling. So as Klegler-Lowry mentioned, we use some VI indicators of monitoring. So first of, before sampling, we provide some PID readings, methane, oxygen, dioxide, carbon, to understand what is the composition of the vital zone atmosphere. In this way, we can understand it, if its potential to biodegradate some petroleum hydrocarbons, or if it's happening some biodegradation, or if there is any methane formation. Methane formation is really, really important to know if that is happening. Even for chlorinated solvents or petroleum hydrocarbons, methane formation is a big issue and could lead to potential dangerous situation, as we could saw in Barão de Mauá case. After that, we have to provide a leak test. It's a test to ensure that the vapor probe, subslab probe, or vapor well, it's tight and there's no leaking. Here in Brazil, we need to use a tracer test with helium or other tracer tests. And the steps are the following. We put this box, known as shroud, enrich this atmosphere inside of the shroud with helium, and then took a sample, and then measure if there, to see if there is helium concentration. If there is helium concentration, probably you have leak and you should abandon this this slab probe and install another or provide the repair of it. And after that, we also sampling with TO15. In this case is Summa canister, but could be a bottle vac. In this case, we have a duplicate sample. So as mentioned before by a vapor pin team, we have a sample train, and we need to do all this type tests here in this connection. So here is we got a connections to provide this test. So when you got results, it's one more problem you have to deal with. I think all Latin American countries have to deal with, because we don't have indoor air concentrations or vapor concentrations in our legislation. So what we're doing, it's using US EPA regional screening levels for it. So at this case, for example, ethylbenzene, how can we calculate what is our vapor screening level? We use the reference here, OSER technical guide from USPA. So we got the target indoor air is the maximum concentration permitted in the USPA. Here we have a carcinogenic risk, 4.9 micrograms per meter cubic. And we have to put in the legislation here in Brazil, the target risk for this contaminants here in Brazil are 10 times higher than USPA, and it's necessary to check in the legislation of each country to provide this fitting to the legislation, right? And then we divide for attenuation factor. Here in Brazil, we use the attenuation factor, the generic attenuation factor provided by USPA in a study in 2012 for residential buildings for chlorinated solvents. So it is really conservative to use this data, because it was residential buildings. So this lab should be more clean, and we don't have a lot of air mixture. So it's not the best thing to use it, but here in São Paulo in Brazil, they are really conservative and are using this attenuation factor. But you can also modeling in your site, or you can also get empirical data in order to understand what is attenuation factor. This attenuation factor is the ratio that your contaminant goes up to the indoor air. So this is the ratio here. So using the generic data, we can calculate what is your vapor screening level for determined contaminant. So here we have for ethylbenzene, it's 1633, And what does mean this plume here? This means that the concentration on soil gas potentially would be, considering this generic attenuation factor, in above target in indoor air, or in other words, above 49 micrograms per meter cubic in indoor air. But as I mentioned before, this attenuation factor is really, really conservative and it's not representing reality. So we went to the field and goes to an indoor sampling at these areas that we should have risk for indoor inhalation. And again, TO15 sampling for 8 hours, a commercial time for industry, that we use a sample train with 8 hours of sampling. And then what we got is really, really low concentrations of ethylbenzene, right? One, we don't got any detections, but in the other, we got some detections. And what is the takeaways from it? So attenuation factors, generic attenuation factors, is really conservative and may not represent your your site, right? So you need to prove it and take some indoor samples. And at the site, we see there is some vapor intrusion issue. There is concentrations that were quantified by the laboratory analysis. So one single sampling event is not enough to understand what happened. So it needs to include more sampling events and understand if the weather conditions should change these concentrations, and then take this to take your decisions and decide it's need to remediate, to mitigate, or what's the next steps for the site. But as I talked before, vapor intrusion at the site was determinant to find where are the sources and properly investigate soil, groundwater, and after vapor intrusion in indoor air. In the second case, it's a chlorinated solvents case. And we used the same approach here. We installed some vapor pins at this building. This building is an office today, but at the past was a machine shop too. And as we can see here, we monitor VOC readings with PID every day. As we can see, we got here in the left part of this the animation, more higher concentration than the other parts. So probably the in the past, these are the areas that could locate the source of contaminations. So after that, we took off some vapor pins, but we decided to let some. So we got 7 SUBSLAB probes here installed and also provide some TO15 sampling, right? The same process as the earlier case. At this point in the left part of the site here, we got high concentrations of TCE, much more higher than others in the same building, right? So probably our source is located near this point, the SUBSLAB probe. One of indicators that the source is near here, it's because we got some chlorinated ethanes here, like TCEA and DCA, and they were part of the solvents in the past. The main compounds of the solvents in the past was TCE, but they were some TCA and DCA, probably TCA at the mixture of the solvent. And at this other building, we got some concentrations, but not as high as this one. And I will demonstrate to you guys what were the groundwater plumen. And you will see that this part of this area, it's not really in the groundwater plume. So should have some soil contamination here. Unfortunately, it's an off area and they didn't allow us to perform some soil samplings here. So this is the groundwater plume at site. And we decide to also provide some indoor air samplings in all buildings in above the groundwater TC, shallow groundwater plumen, and also provide outdoor sample here to understand, because this is a industrial area, and understand if there's any cross contamination in this part of the site. So any concentrations presented, TCE concentrations above the quantification limit, but I would like to highlight some discoveries with this indoor air sampling campaign. At this point, we provide two samples here in different times. The first time, we got some 1,4 dichlorobenzene concentrations in other parts too. And we have talked to the people who work there, the cleaning staff, to understand what should cause this concentration, because we don't have any 1,4 dichlorobenzene in groundwater or soil. And what we found, that was this contamination provenient from odorizers. So people were using odorizers during sampling, and this caused our 1,4 dichlorobenzene contamination. So we went there after this information, explained to the people to not use these in few days before and during the sampling, and we didn't get any concentrations above standards. So it's really important to keep and maintain some contaminants of concern and avoiding letting out all the potential contaminants. But I think we should maintain sewer gases in our compounds of concern, but we should take a look really close to others that won't give us a lot of information, like this case. Okay, so that's why what I have to talk about, and feel free to send me emails or add me at LinkedIn to more information. Thank you.
Thank you, William. Thank you for your presentation. It's a very good presentation. We're very thankful that you came today. We have a lot of questions to be answered, and I hope we have enough time to answer all the questions. I have a list of questions here. I took the time to translate them into English. So I'm going to be asking the questions to the panelists, and if you are comfortable answering, please do, or you can pass it over. So I have the first question here. It's a question from Renzo. He's saying, good morning. More than a year ago, I had the opportunity to participate in a identification of contaminated site in a subsoil where 30 years ago, various chemical substances and pesticides were buried. In a preliminary investigation, electrical tomography and georadar techniques were used, identifying concentrations of resistivity in the shade of feeder. I didn't get the complete investigation for the work-related reasons, but the consulting team, before starting the identification sampling, was very worried about evacuations due to the liberation of gases that had been concentrated for several years. They calculated a volume of 1.5 tons of contaminated soil. Since there wasn't a previous characterization of the contaminated soil, Since there wasn't a previous characterization of contaminated soil, what procedure could vapor pin help with in this case?
I'll start in on that answer.
Hey, join us.
Yeah, it'll have a long answer, I have a feeling. If you wanted to use the vapor pin in that situation, you'd have to have a hard surface. So if it was just out in the soil itself and you didn't have like a concrete cover or some kind of a hard surface, you wouldn't be able to use the vapor pin directly. But if you're worried about the releases during excavations, there is fence line monitoring procedures you can use to do that. And we do that typically in the US. So we monitor the concentrations in the ambient air as the site progresses. And at times you have to then knock down the vapors with some kind of a surfactant or something like that to spray into the hole just to keep the vapors from becoming too concentrated. Willem, did you have anything you wanted to add?
No, I think it's perfect. And maybe you would understand what are the vapors that you had, and maybe a soil sampling, a soil vapor soil sampling would be great to understand and prepare the team what you got and right, get the right PPE, right, for the workers.
Right.
I mean, it would be great too. So I think vapor peeing would help if has concrete or slab at this point, or you can also install a vapor well or something like that, or a direct push directly and take a vapor sampling.
Okay, thank you for the answer. Now I have a question here from Lucio. Have you ever heard about analysis of caffeine in soil air with VP, with vapor peeing?
As long as it's volatile, you can sample anything with vapor pen. That's why we indicate that you can use it for pressure field testing. So as long as it's a volatile substance and you have a method, an analytical method that you can evaluate it with, then yes, you can analyze it with the vapor pen.
Usually the part that becomes difficult on compounds that are a little bit outside of the normal range of compounds is that you have to have the standard made up, and that can be very expensive for an air standard so that you can calibrate the instruments correctly at the lab. That would be something you'd have to talk to the lab about. But if it is volatile enough, you will be able to detect it. As we move into PFAS and PFOAs and those kind of things, there's a lot of speculation that they may be as volatile, even though they're large compounds, as volatile as a lot of other compounds are. And we may start to look for those in soil gas. So it's kind of wide open. It really depends on what the list is the lab can analyze for.
Willem?
Yes, I never heard about caffeine and indoor air or soil vapor, but I agree with a few guys, PFAS and PFOAs, that mainly the precursors with alcohol in the molecular will be something that will be tracking vapor intrusion issues, indoor air samples too. But sorry, Lucy, I never heard about caffeine.
A lot of times you can use absorbents to concentrate the sample. So if you use a TO17 tube, so when we do mercury vapor analyses, we have to connect up an absorbent to the vapor pen and pump through a large amount of air from the subsurface through the absorbent, and then that helps to concentrate the sample to get enough sample on the absorbent to actually analyze it. And so if you know how much vapor you ran by the absorbent, you can get a concentration that way, but it has to be a known volume.
Okay, thank you for the answer. I have another question here from Daniel Jesus Arana Santos. For PID readings in rainforest zones in field studies, what recommendations can you give? For receiving the sample in a container, he commended a way of experiencing that we did with some first use receptacles, but all of them gave different values, and there wasn't a standard oscillation.
I don't know if I understand all the questions, but I will start with PID readings. So PID readings would be different for each day as demonstrated before, because of mainly in a forest zone, because the humidity, temperature difference, and all this kind of weather conditions. So PID readings should vary a lot, right? So, but regarding analytical concentrations, I don't know if I got the questions, but maybe it would be related to different types of sampling techniques or also related to different days of samples as your PID readings are showing to you. But if are different contaminants, maybe there is a problem that you should take a look very closely what is happening. I don't know if Craig and Laurie have something more to say.
I think you're
muted.
I agree with Willem that the biggest issue for PIDs, especially sort of the older models, is humidity. Once the little window inside the PID gets a little humidity on, it starts to just have kind of random readings. So they're very, very sensitive. If you have a PPB sort of detector, they're the most sensitive to humidity. Now, there are some new ones coming out, new PIDs that they claim aren't affected by humidity, but we haven't had a chance to use any of those yet.
Okay, thank you. I have a question here from Kevin Grunfeld. I think this is for Lauren Craig. Hi, thank you for the presentation. In the video, it shows two types of installations, right? One corresponds to a sample that is done for single sample stick up installation. The installation on the right, and the other is used for a permanent installation for long-term monitoring. Is that correct?
Actually, you can use either installation for multiple samples. The idea of a stick up is you just want to make sure, let's say if you're installing that stick up, the first one we installed that was a stick up in a facility that was not active anymore and no one was going to come in and mess with it, then you could leave it as a stick up. But the reason for the flush mount is in case it's an active facility, just to keep it secure and make sure that no one's going to tamper with your sampling port. So that's really the only difference, but you can utilize them either way because you can also install a flush mount and make it a one-time sampling if you wanted to. I hope that answers the question.
I was muted, sorry. Thank you for the answer. I have a question here from Maria José Villalobos. In which cases it is recommended to use passive soil gas sampling and when active soil gas sampling? Can you tell us some pros and cons for both techniques?
I think I could start this one, if you don't mind. Passive soil sampling, it's great for source identification, and it has a really low quantification limit, and I like to use it a lot. But also we have a higher price compared when we do PID readings and also Tedlar bags. It's a great sample. You will have a medium of mass absorbed at the time of your sampling, and you won't see this variation, but it's quite accuracy for source identification, and you will see what's your compounds of concern. So I like the approach too. For indoor air passive sampling, you should use too, and you give you this pondered media of the contamination. So it's also a good way to look, but as I mentioned before in my talking, indoor air and also soil gas really change according to the weather conditions. So you have to look this as when you have to understand your conceptual side model and understand your results to have your answer and take a decision.
Yeah, if I can add to that as well. The passive samplers, you have to make sure that the lab that you're using has done sort of uptake studies on their particular absorbents, because that's the only way you can get from a mass to a concentration. So if you have to compare it to a standard, you'd have to know how fast it gets absorbed onto the absorbent. And there's lots of labs that have done those studies. The other one is sometimes the list of compounds is a little bit limited. For the passive samplers, yeah. So if you wanted to do soil gas studies and you wanted to look at tetrahydrofuran, you wouldn't be able to use a passive sampler because they don't tend to have any studies on those, and they don't have them in their suite of compounds that they use as calibration standards. So make sure you check with your lab before you start out, and you'll save yourself a lot of headache. They are kind of expensive to use by the time, they're easy to handle because they're small and they're easy to deploy. There's no kind of leak detection or anything like that you have to monkey around with. but
they are good for indoor air.
Yeah, and they are good for indoor air because they give you that average concentration, but they can be kind of expensive.
Okay, thank you for the answer. I have Lydia. She's going back to the answer about the caffeine. She says that I think they are the volatile compounds in coffee. Caffeine is soluble in water for the decaffeination process, but I don't have handy the boiling point to see the ambient temperature. I think she was adding to the answer. So I have a question.
Go ahead. Well, I have a little bit of a familiarity with caffeine. It's not environmental.
Lots of coffee.
Okay.
Go ahead.
So I have a tracer for pharmaceuticals and other stuff that human uses for treatment, and it's impacting Brazilian sewers. So I think it's a good tracer, but it's really new to me for indoor and soil vapor too.
Thank you. Now I have another question here from Xavier Coelho. Good morning. I got a question. Is it possible to simulate the movements of vapor in known saturated zones?
Simulate the movement of vapor in gaseous.
Go ahead, Willem.
Yeah, I think it's possible, but it's quite of hard. Emulating, and I think there is some mathematical modeling for it, but it's quite hard, and I don't know, I'm not a specialist about it, but I know, and I see some mathematical modeling regarding vapor movement in vapor zone. It's like a hydraulic movement, but there's other inputs.
Okay, thank you. So now I have a question from Pedro Valadares. What programs or softwares are generally used for model contaminants in soil?
There's a lot, but the most part of it's for groundwater modeling. So you can use mud flow, and you can use from some analytical models like Bioscreen, Bioclar. I think we got a lot of them. I don't know lots in my mind. Maybe Craig could help us with a little more.
Yeah, from a vapor intrusion standpoint, there's really not a good model for soil to vapor. There's just so many complicating factors within that they've just said it's just almost impossible to model it. You'd think it'd be easy. If you had a soil sample concentration, you should be able to get some vapor concentration off that. But it just doesn't work. So Johnson and Ettinger model that was used, at the beginning of vapor intrusion assessments, they did come up with a soil to indoor air kind of a model, but they have abandoned that pretty quickly just because it was so, it just never calibrated very well. And it didn't really connect up with the truth. So there's not a lot to do. It's hard to do soil vapor from soil. It's just almost impossible. It's easier just to collect the soil vapor sample.
Yes, it's really hard to calibrate these models. Also biovapor, it's also Johnson and Ettinger, but they put these biodegradations for petroleum hydrocarbons too. It's
beautiful,
but it's kind of hard to do it. And you can also provide some empirical data using flux chamber, soil gas, and indoor air, and you can find your attenuation factor for your site and modeling.
Yeah.
You're muted, Guy.
Oh, sorry about that. Okay, I think Laura already answered that question for Ransel during the Q&A. We answered this question, so I'm moving to the next one from David Lopez. How representative would be the soil gas sampling? It seems samples are taken from the surface soil. Thanks.
Yes, he wanted to know when we took that sip of air at the top, how representative it is at the bottom, because we found DNAPL 15 feet below the surface. It was very representative. When our first time we did it, we got a little nervous because we started digging and said, oh my gosh, why did we find this big hotspot, but we weren't finding any results? And it was amazing that once we got really deep, it was just screaming with TCE. So we have found that it is very representative. And if you have specifics, we actually have connections that you can put at the bottom of the vapor pen if you wanted to go to a specific depth and take a sample. Or if you, let's say you were in a dry cleaner site and or your slab was saturated with chlorinated solvents, we actually have a sealing extension that you could put on the bottom to make sure you're blocking off not only the slab itself, but the very bottom of the slab so that you're getting a representative sample from underneath.
Yeah, and I think for prospecting for sources, which is the same thing that Willem did, you end up looking at the shape of the data in visually looking at it in that way. It's hard to take a concentration and then go back and say, okay, there's this much in the soil. It's the same issue with the soil to indoor air kind of modeling. It just doesn't work very well. But once you get the shapes mapped out, then you understand you have a hot spot nearby. The nice thing about soil gas is you don't have to actually, you're getting the media to sample is the gas, but it tends to be a halo around something that's contaminated at depth. And so that's how it helps you locate those sources.
Yes, and I would add that the subslab concentrations are important for human health risk assessment, that where the vapors go through cracks and maybe pipes or something like that. So may not represent the source zone, but represents where the contaminants flows to the receptor, the humans, and the indoor air. So for me, it's really important to human health risk assessment, this information.
Thank you. Now I have a question here from Williams Casimiro Vida. Good morning. How do you control the escape of volatile contaminants? Does regulations exist for buying these gases, VOCs? In the case of risk site, what remediation technology do you recommend? Thank you.
Okay, so as far as I understand that you have a vapor intrusion issue problem, you should apply some techniques. If you have a vapor zone, then you should apply vacuum. You use SVE, soil vapor extraction, or you can use also an SSDS, so a subslab depressurization system. The difference between them are the SVE applies a higher vacuum than an SSDS, right? And also you can put some passive barriers, like Laurie said before, and other passive methods to dry these vapors and put to the atmosphere, right? I think this is the most common techniques. And also provide soil and groundwater remediations that would help to get lower the concentrations of vapors. And then you finish your problem and you don't need to apply this SVE and SSDS or other kinds of mitigation systems running through a long time.
Okay, thank you. We answer the question from Williams. Now we have a question from Carlos Armero. And Pedro, do you want to ask that question in Spanish and we'll get the translation? Well, I can translate that real quick here.
Sin problema, Guillermo. ¿Me escuchan?
Yes, we can hear you.
Not a problem, Guillermo.
Okay.
Vamos.
Carlos Armero consulta. Por lo visto, los vapor pins
Carlos se instalan Armero prácticamente asks, en It seems that the vapor pins are
Estos
installed virtually on the surface.
¿Hasta qué profundidad?
¿Es posible instalar gases from that
tratamiento para lograr medir gases a mayor
profundidad? Additive to measure gases at greater depths?
Yes, the answer, the quick part of, well, yes, they are installed right at the surface. They do collect, you know, a sample from the immediate area at the bottom of it, but you can add extensions, and we do have some barb fittings and things that you can add pieces of tubing to, so you can collect at greater depth. The practical part of that is you have to have a small diameter drill bit that you can drill down to a certain depth, and those are maybe 1.5 meters it would be about as far as you could go.
You are purging all the ambient air that is anything before you've installed it.
Yeah.
So even like our first case study showed, you know, we installed those right there at that surface, but the Dean apple was 15 feet below the surface when we pinpointed that. That wasn't, we didn't have anything attached to the bottom of the pins. That was just sampling as we installed them.
Thank you.
Gracias por la respuesta.
Thank you for your answers.
Tenemos una pregunta más de Renzo Rivera. En el Perú,
we have another question from Renzo Rivera. In Peru, there is
se sobreentiende que el uso de PID es de forma referencial.
The PID is an equipment that it's used by a few consulting companies. It is understood that it's used, it's just as a reference, because in Peru there is an entity that oversees the equipment gauging or calibration, the INACAL, but there is no laboratory to record this type of equipment. What other equipment or methods could be used to monitor in replacement of the PID?
I think both Willem and I are all gonna, and Willem, you can tell me if you confer, but the PID, like Craig had mentioned, it does not give you those exact measurements or specify what type of compound it is detecting. It is a source just to help you do that source testing. And that's why you still need the vapor pen and to pull a sample so that you can get the relative and actual compounds that you're trying to analyze.
Yeah, and I think it, for the most part, most people use a PID for health and safety issues as well. So when you go to a site and you're doing your work, you're kind of screening the ambient air in the breathing space just to see if there are any volatiles being generated. And then you might screen a soil sample just to see if it's interesting enough to send to a lab. That's how they've been used in the past for the most part. I would think you still want to have a PID. I'm not sure how you do your health and safety issues in Peru. But
we'll take this one. Go ahead, Willem.
Yes, and I think PID, even if you don't have a lot of people who can calibrate your equipment, you can calibrate yourself with, for example, isobutylene, and using as a screening tool, as Craig and Laurie mentioned, and I and myself. So after that, after you provide screening at your site and understand where are the contaminants, and you provide soil samplings, groundwater, and also vapor samples, and then these samples will be with lab approval, right? So you don't need exactly to your PID have this calibration. Since the what will lead your management on the site is soil, groundwater, and vapor samples. I don't know if I completed your answer, but I think it's a way to deal with if in Peru.
It's a very well answered, Willem. Thank you very much.
Welcome.
Thank you. So I have the last question here. We ran out of time now. This question is from Nicholas Franco. Did you find some relationship between GW level variation and PID readings, vapor measurements?
Yeah, I can take that. In many of my case, yes. Really, for shallow levels of groundwater, this is really, really important to understand what are groundwater variations and the PID readings and also vapor samplings. This has a really important interference on the results. Since if the source of vapors are groundwater, this could lead to higher concentrations when groundwater is more closer to the surface, right?
Thank you, Aaron. So this is the end of the webinar. I'd like to thank you sincerely to the speakers and panelists today, and thanks to all of you for your attendance. And the message I leave here is by sharing our knowledge, we can care for the planet more effectively. So the recordings will be available next week. And I'd like to ask Pedro if you want to add something else, Pedro, so we can end.
Sí, muchas gracias, Guillermo.
Yes, thank you very much, Guilherme, to thank all the panel members, the participants, Lori, Craig, Willem, and from Report PIN. And I would like to invite you to www.minamp.gov.bp. We will be sending you the link for the recordings of this presentation and also other invites for other technical seminars. Go ahead, Guilherme.
Thank you. Thank you again, Pedro. And thank you everyone for coming. And I wish you a very good weekend.
Thank you, Willem. Thank you very much. Thank you,
good
Pedro.
To see everybody.
Nice to see everybody. Take care. Stay safe. Thank
Hopefully
you.
We'll see you in person soon.
Take care.
Thank you, guys.
Bye. Stay safe. Bye. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. Thank you.